Hello, my name is Morty. I'm here to read the presentation originally given at our Spotlight event. This video will contain the presentation and live footage from that event. I hope you enjoy and find it informative. So let's start. The Post-Pandemic Performance Project. What is it? Officially founded in 2020, as it says on the box, the Post-Pandemic Performance Project is a performance project. To date, we have performed pantos and plays with lots of versatile plans for the future. Our style is to think outside the box. Although initially the original intention was to do an original panto adaptation of Dickens' A Christmas Carol, lockdown provided time and space to rethink and reinvent what the Post-Pandemic Performance Project should be about. Pure originality. We work with people who are interested in performance arts, and we raise money for local charities and causes. Success to date. To date, we have raised £4,766.80 for local charities and causes, including Donington Doorstep, The Porch, Oxfordshire Crews Bereavement Support, Helen and Douglas House, and Florence Park Community Centre's Over 60s Free Friday Lunch Club. Initially, and still wherever possible, we work on a zero to low budget. This means we source and make our own props and scenery and costume pieces. We are very grateful to venues and sponsors who have helped offer us free and paid for performance spaces. Our participants have also kindly offered voluntary contributions to help with rehearsal and show space too. But with the cost of living increasing, we will begin to look for more sponsors to help fund performance and dress rehearsal spaces, hopefully helping spread the word about their business in return. We try and avoid applying for grants. We want to continue to put together shows by reusing, recycling materials, showcasing them and local talents in our performances. Our rehearsals, except for dress and tech rehearsals, often take place in free spaces such as gardens and parks, sometimes even homes. So let's talk about the first panto we did, Spectre Avenue. This was performed in October 2021. And we had people from different backgrounds who fancied doing something different with this original script. The script saw two youths who were told by their mothers to go and find a job. So they ventured into their home town, Cowley Town, but they met a wizard who was a little bit dodgy and set them on a mission to find a magical scroll that could better their lives. And that recording is on YouTube if you'd like to see. So here's some more photos of some of the participants, and you can see the beautiful background that was made for us by local artists. And lots more photos here, custard pies and wonderful props such as the boat. And costumes as well, the ghost costume, the gargoyles costume, all handmade. And finally, more photos of backstage dancers and band and audience. We were very fortunate to have a wonderful audience for this production. Our next one was in May 2022. It was Apparitions Anonymous, a ghost play. I also wrote this play and had the help of a co-writer to add the embellishments on the storyline I had in my head for quite a while and wanted to execute. And I'm very proud of how it turned out, as I was also with all the productions we've done. So Apparitions Anonymous saw a group of three friends who met in their local pub in the Victorian era, and they would go and discuss the paranormal. But one day, a fourth member shows up, and truths start getting revealed. And as you can see from some of the photos, the tensions build as well. And on this next slide, you can see photos of even some people in modern clothing, a tour guide, namely on the top right there. So I'll let you have a look at that film on YouTube and reveal the twists. And some lovely show photos here as well. That backdrop as well was made in a garden with bed sheets that were sewn together and printed stencils and masking tape. Very talented people helping with the art on our shows. The next one was the Jester Trial. So this was actually this year as well, in September, our second panto. This was co-written with my previous co-writer, James Freeman, who also worked on Apparitions Anonymous with me. This saw two youths again, very different from the ones in Cowley Town. These were very much rebels without a cause, and they ventured into their, into the next town along to try and better their lives by entering the medieval jester trials. And they met some people along the way, including dragons and trolls and, of course, the dame. And it was, I think, a fulfilling story again with a nice moral at the end. Again, we'll let you see that for yourselves, which is also on YouTube. So again, some of the... we decided to use... I wanted a plain background for this one and to try and focus on using the props, costumes and scenery pieces to go on, namely to try and help change the settings a bit easier. With Spectre Avenue, we had the beautiful Oxford background. But when there was the cooking scene, for instance, inside the house, it perhaps maybe didn't quite fit. And so I thought if we had a plain background and used scenery we could take on and off, that might work better. I'm always looking at ways of improving and changing, as you do in the arts, to better your craft. More photos here, and you can see... Our technician here, who I'll talk about later, sound and lighting. And here's some of the scenery I was talking about earlier. And if you look, we have a COVID shield in the left middle group of pictures there. Now, the most recent play we've done is part of an anthology play that a series that I've been writing called The Vault Volumes. The play we did was called The Inn with the Hidden Window. Now, the Vault Volumes are a series of plays, but it doesn't matter whether you've seen them all or not, because they only link by a fairy tale book called The Vault Volumes. Each play will have a different fairy tale in The Vault Volumes, which may or may not dictate what happens to the characters in the play. Now, this particular story, The Inn with the Hidden Window, was set in a bookshop. A customer came to reap the wonderful rewards that old bookshops have, but was disappointed to find it was closing down. However, he made friends with the owner, and this beautiful friendship developed. So this was a much smaller cast. We had two main actors playing the leads, Ian Wilkinson and Ray Claridge. And we were joined by Nick Dewey as a solicitor. And we had a cameo at the end. I had a tiny cameo, and also Ian's daughter, Ava. It was quite well received, and really happy with it. I thought the actors brought it to life beautifully. That is on YouTube as well, so you can enjoy that. The next one we are rehearsing for is The Vault Volumes, The Figure Up on the Hearth. This one's a horror, a bit different to the one we just did. And you may see some familiar faces again, but we've rotated the main roles, and we try and give everyone a bit of a chance at getting involved in ways they want, as I will talk about a bit later. So yeah, please do come and see that. So who are we? I am TL Williams. That's my pen name. If you know me more personally, I'm Morty. I'm the writer, the founder, and the director. I've had no previous experience or post-16 training in the arts, but a lifelong fiery ambition to give it a go. And so far, it's not going too badly. Performers. Our performers have come from various backgrounds, from some who have never performed before, to others performing in community pantos, and actors who have had professional training and have performed on main stages, such as Oxford Playhouse. Everyone is considered equal, and we encourage everyone to share ideas, try things out, and feel comfortable just having a go. Our dancers and choreographers. So we've been fortunate to have a guest choreographer on Spectre Avenue. We've had guest dancers twice, the Strawberry Fair Majorettes, and our own participants have choreographed too. Voice performers. We try and include performers who want to participate but can't commit the time or aren't ready to be on stage by offering voice roles, which we then play in the shows. Tech. So the student becomes the master. Our wonderful tech guy, sound and lighting technician, Francesco Walker, he started by co-operating with a local professional, Alan Brown, for our first panto. And by our next production, he was solo and letting another participant shadow. And this participant was then able to cover when our technician was absent. And actually, that participant, Tegan, did the lighting for us in the first half of Spotlight as well. So sound was supported by one of our performers in Spectre Avenue, Chris. He was playing the Dame at the time as well. And we also had a live band for that. And then Chris also operated the sound for us on Apparitions Anonymous and was an extra. So really, there is lots to dip into if you want to. Photography and videography. So people have been or part of or have seen the shows and then fancied having a go at capturing them on film have been constantly learning about angles and shots throughout rehearsals and productions. So Francesco does a lot of filming, and we've had Nina has got into filming and really enjoying that and is looking at editing. Zoe, who is often an actor with us, has got a keen interest in looking at professional photography now and did the photo shoot for The Inn with the Hidden Window. All our photos are on our website, so do have a look. But we're also very lucky to be joined by a local photographer, Andrew, who captured Spectre Avenue for us free of charge. So as I mentioned, Francesco's done some filming, and he also does sound and lighting, but he's wonderful at video editing as well, and he's produced some superb films of our shows. We have had interest from a college student too for future productions, and are keen for everyone to get a chance at learning, practicing, and perfecting. Creative team then. So from advisory to actually making, people from different creative backgrounds get involved in making props, scenery, and costume pieces. We've had artistic participants who give us the hand and are always very keen on welcoming new people who want to learn and get involved in this area. On the backstage and front of house, we've been very fortunate to have support doing both, and these are from people who just support us and want to do something. There are some people are former participants and some are friends of the Post-Pandemic Performance Project, such as our wonderful Karen, who has been every single show helping front of house, backstage, everything. Really grateful to her and to everyone who helps us. So as you can see, there's some photos here. We've got Karen there on the raffle, Steph and Claire at the top. Steph does a lot of art with us. Claire was in Spectre Avenue and Apparitions Anonymous and came back with Jester Charles to help backstage. And the choreography in the middle there, we've got Alice, who joined us to do some choreography on Spectre Avenue. And Sarah and Viv making that beautiful backdrop. Zoe doing some painting. Lots of lovely activities go on in the making and preparing of our shows. And we've got some more photos here of sort of backstage and rehearsals, some choreography. Zoe at the top right there, Alice in the bottom left. There's Nina on film, Sarah and Steph working on that backdrop. So the top one is for Spectra Avenue, and the bottom one was for Apparitions Anonymous. So you can see, done in the garden. And then there's backstage photos from Apparitions Anonymous at the top there with Buster and Anna, who joined us on that show. So, why is there a post-pandemic performance project? Sometimes it can be nerve-wracking or off-putting when searching for performance groups for fear of them being a bit clicky. And although this is often not the case, many productions start up with fresh people too. Believe it or not, I wasn't at all confident before I started up the post-pandemic performance project, but life had been a bit challenging and it was time to follow a dream. So starting up the project presented a new focus, challenge and passion. It was down to the support of others that meant that I was able to make this dream a reality. And that is why we always fundraise for others, because community goes a long way. We encourage new participants of all ages and backgrounds to join all the time. We try and switch up roles, both on stage and helping backstage and with front of house. We want to give people the opportunity to try new things, a safe space to explore performance, share ideas and learn, but most of all, make friendships and have fun. And that we do. And as you can see, more lovely photos here. So we've got some before shows, after shows, during rehearsals, promo shots. Yeah, there's some here during shows that that can be quite a laugh, with getting ready to go on. As you can see, Ian in the bottom corner is a jester with custard pies ready. All fun, exciting times. And some rehearsals in the rain, some in the sun, some in the halls. Lots of smiling faces though. And the after parties are usually a good laugh. So where is the post-pandemic performance project? Well, as you can see from the photos, all over the place. But to date, we have performed at Cali Workers Social Club and Florence Park Community Centre, which we really love. Thank you, Florence Park. As we explore new projects, we'd love to explore new performance settings. The possibilities are endless. We rehearse in a variety of spaces, such as halls, the park, gardens, and sometimes homes. And thanks to our videographers and editor, we are also on YouTube. When is it? It's all year round. We started rehearsing the Spectre Avenue on Zoom in early 2021. And we performed in September 2021. We performed 3 more shows. 5 shows are booked for 2023 with the aforementioned hopes for more, including backstage and presents, which will give others the chance to write, direct and perform productions with our support. So anything from 1 to 5 shows a year. We rehearse to suit the availability of performers. Currently, we have 3 separate rehearsal schedules for our next show to work on the play at our actors' convenience, which we will piece together in an all-day tech dress rehearsal. Where possible, we try and avoid clashing with similar style productions. So, for example, our pantos have been in September, October, and our next one is in November as part of the Vault Volumes. How can you help? Get involved! On stage, backstage, front of house, creative, so much more. We always find something for people to do that want to have that experience. If you're not kind of into that, that's no problem. Help us spread the word. Or come and see our shows. So the Vault Volume shows are the 24th of Feb, 28th of April, the 16th of June, the 22nd of September and the 24th of November. What next? As I just mentioned, 2023 is booked up with the Vault Volumes, but our next play is a horror, The Figure Up on the Hearth, and that's raising money for Restore. The Vault Volume series includes a play inside a play, a monastery setting, a time warp and a mini panto. On the wish list are projects such as a rom-com play, Stave to Stage, Promenade, Backstage, Ruby workshop sessions, and post-pandemic performance project presents, endorsing a new playwrights, directors, and talents. So a little bit like what we've done with Spotlight, but on a bigger scale. We're always looking for new participants to join our journey. Get in touch. Social media, with Facebook or on Instagram, Twitter, because they're the only social media accounts I know how to use. And you can look at our website, YouTube, and email, or come and say hi if you see me about and you have any questions or want to chat further. I think I'm quite approachable and I'd be happy to chat. So now the bit you've been waiting for, Spotlight. We have the performances were phenomenal, and I'm so proud that everyone that took part in the show, as you will see, we have some of our own participants who'd written, directed and choreographed pieces. We had guests who'd written pieces for the third Whispers of Winter anthology, all proceeds of which will benefit Florence Park Community Centre, the Over 60s Free Friday Lunch Club. And we had a speed workshop. So we had a couple of groups pick out of a box, a piece of paper with a place, a profession or occupation, and a random object or thing. And they had 10 minutes to think of a script and then 10 minutes to rehearse it. And then they performed it. And you will see those performances a little later on. So let me just say thank you to everyone who has been or is involved in the post-pandemic performance project, and thank you so much for listening. We hope you get involved in the future in any way, from being part of to seeing our shows. And now, Spotlight. I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Winter memories. This year will be my first one as a granddad, and it makes me remember when I was just a lad. I fondly remember winter when thinking back. We never had much, but love we didn't lack. Mum and Dad filled long nights with such fun. The season of good cheer had begun. Our rosy cheeks as we squealed with delight to see snow on the ground. Such a joyful sight. Icicles would hang from the roof and windowsill. We'd wrap up warm and pull a sledge up a hill. Snowballs would soak our gloves and our hands would be in pain. Warming up by the fire so we could do it all again. Getting up to see my dad before he'd leave for work. Frozen windows, icy designs of Jack Frost work. Walking home from school, and it's already dark. Trees were bare, but often with snow-covered bark. In December, the excitement grew week by week. Christmas Eve, though tired, we struggled to fall asleep. Listening for Santa's reindeer, leaving them a snack. The amazement of waking and finding presents in a sack. It's now only 18 more sleeps to go before Christmas Day. I'm looking forward to creating new memories along the way. So have a Merry Christmas, beware of any ice, and enjoy your time with loved ones, be they naughty or nice.
At least it was quiet where I was sitting in my exceedingly cosy armchair by the fire in my tiny cabin. Outside, a howling blizzard raged. A pipe was in my mouth and I contentedly blew a smoke ring. I was just closing my eyes for a nap when a bang on the door boomed through my small cottage and made me jump from my seat. Bang! Cautiously, I crept towards the door. I had no acquaintances, so it surprised me to have someone knocking at my front door, especially in a blizzard at 11 p.m. Slowly, I opened it. Snow billowed in, and by the light from my candle and the fire at the side of the room, I saw a man breathing heavily. He staggered inside and spoke in a rasping voice, "I need shelter." me, I said, with rather too much surprise and rather too little of truth. I've been enjoying my evening alone. Thank you, he replied. He shuffled forward and slumped down in my armchair. My favourite armchair. Still, I didn't say anything. After making us each a hot mug of tea, I dragged a stool across the room, placed it on the other side of the fire, and sat down. I took a good look at him. A curtain of frost covered his face and his lips were blue. He was shivering uncontrollably, wore thick wool gloves, but I could see that he was missing his fifth finger on his left hand as the finger of the glove was flopping down over his other fingers. His eyes seemed to be glazed with an intensely thin yet visible layer of frost. I shuddered. So, who are you? I said, attempting to spark conversation. After sipping his tea, he said, I am Theodore Grisdane, explorer and traveller, at your service. I am Arthur Godwinson, a quiet gentleman who lives in the middle of nowhere and has no profession. Pleased to meet you, I replied. We shook hands. When our palms met, an icy cold bolted up my arm and into my heart. Are you familiar with these parts? I asked. As a matter of fact, I've been here before.
Really?
Yes, I was travelling through this place when a terrible blizzard, just like this one, struck. I saw a light in the distance. When I begged the resident for shelter, he refused. Dad, that was probably my father. He kept himself to himself, my old man. I chuckled. His facial expression did not change. I notice you have finished your tea. Would you like a new one? I asked. He looked at me. I got to my feet and strode out of the room. As I brewed the tea, I pondered about who this fellow could be. Having come to no conclusion, I noticed the tea was ready. I came back into the room. He was nowhere to be seen. No footprints marked the snow the blizzard had blown in when the man had entered. He had not left the cabin. But there was nowhere to hide in this tiny place. He was completely gone. The cold seemed to leak through the wooden boards and freeze me solid.
It scattered around in front of my house as I attempted to fist a falling rock. I learned to thick humans to fall the biting cold, and the snowmen with tiny carrot noses. I had stood up at the sky, observing, the first time I had held my head up, tall and high. I compare it to my second encounter, preferring to look at my shoes that plunged into endless way. Those shoe-shaped caverns likened me to the air. My fascination had led me to discover them, finding that if you stare at the snow for just long enough, you'll see them glow, iridescent little things captured on the ground.
The cold, snow-filled wind blew past me. It was honestly rather annoying, the fact that the wind kept flowing through the crevices of my woolen knit scarf. Snow piled up and got in my boots. I began to walk further into the snowy forest. It was still light outside. I had plenty of time to stay here. However, I do still keep track of the hours that go by. The hours went by and the wind only hit harder. It was starting to become dark. I can't believe I'd lost track of time, the thing I swore to keep track of. Then a rustling noise, although it was more of a small crashing tree type of noise, emerged from the forest. What's that sound? I questioned myself, although being alone in the forest, hopefully. But at the very least, I had to go home before it really became dark. I started to progress through the forest again, but then I heard that annoying tree crashing sound again. This time, I decided to investigate, so I walked over to the source of the noise, where I spotted two directions. One direction held the source of the noise, and the other direction was just the more forest. I decided to go to the source of the noise for fun. It was most likely some loggers, but I'm sure someone else would have called some sort of ranger or whoever kept the forest pristine and clean at that time. I strolled along the path with the white blanket of snow crunching under my feet. Eventually, I came across a dilapidated shack. Was somehow still standing, although most of its walls had collapsed onto the ground. The shack was completely covered in snow. The door had been through its time, and seemed like it had been shot with a revolver many times from the end of the hall structure in it. Its frame had obviously come loose, and the shack's windows, if you even call it a shack at this point, had been broken with shards of glass on the floor on the inside. I jogged inside, hoping for some warmth. The inside was bland, and the wallpaper was dull. My hands went numb, and the wind lapped against my cheeks. It seemed as though the cold wind had consumed the shack. Rather a shame, as my feet started to go numb too. But nonetheless, I made the most of it and sat down on a broken stool. It immediately collapsed under my weight. Then I heard what I can only describe as a growling bear noise coming from outside the window. I thought of it as just the wind, as something so disturbing would just scare me. But yet again, the noise came, louder than ever. Now I had two options. The first option was to run away like a small child, discovering what smoking was. My second option was go over the noise and not be the small child. I immediately made up my mind. It was the most obvious option, to go over to the sound and possibly be threatened by a bear. Maybe I could have got footage too if my camera lens hadn't frozen up with all this freezing cold weather. But lenses are lenses, so footageless, I was going to explore the sound one way or another. I began to traverse the terrain to find the source of the noise, for real, without stopping for a broken down shack. Then began the 5-minute journey to the sound. That'd be a rather good book title I could publish if you ask me ever. I began to carry on walking after a while, much longer than 5 minutes. I made it to the sound and found a rabbit on the floor. It lay limply on the ground. It seemed like it had a leg injury. Luckily, the rabbit had no broken bones, so I slowly helped it stand up and carried it to an area with a rabbit population. Hopefully it found safety with other rabbits. My rabbit knowledge isn't too good. Then it came down on me like a hammer on a nail. A bear could be nearby, and I decided to try option one again. Run away like a small child and get back home. But then, something caught my attention again, which was annoying because I was about to go home. I heard rustling like someone was watching me. This was really like one of those scary books that ends up with a Scooby-Doo style ending. I began to run away when a large bear approached me. Then I realised why the wounds looked similar to bite marks. The bites were actually from a bear, and I was getting approached by a bear. I knew I needed to slowly walk away and seem like a non-threatening predator to its cubs or the bear itself. It was rather quite obvious the more I thought about it. But that was the thing, because I had already faded out when the bear approached me. It was covered in the most apparent clue for me to deduce who the predator was. But now was the time. I was not a predator. Not questioning my amazing detective skills. Before I could run away, it started to walk close to me and began to growl. I began to think about backing it out and running away, which was my plan. In an attempt to get him to stop approaching close to me, I began to sit down and beg. It was a way of trying to seem less intimidating. Suddenly, it began to stop growling and started to move closer. He began to start sniffing me. At first, it seemed a way of identifying me, and then it started to back away. It must have not seen me as a threat and backed off to tend to its cubs' needs and to protect them. At that moment, I decided to leg it and run from the bear. Well, sadly, my legs had already gone numb as it was winter. The cold, dry air of winter made it hard to breathe normally. The weather had also turned distasteful, as it was now close to 6:45 in the evening. I began to run, but my asthma kicked in, and I fell to the snowy floor to catch my breath. I looked back at the forest and the bear. They had left the surrounding area. My breath was ragged, and my legs were out of power to walk back. The cold environment of winter was rather hard to stay in without winter gear. I began to eventually get back up and start walking again. It was rather a dangerous and tiresome way to spend Christmas Eve, but I was sure I'd got home before it was too late. Winter wasn't so bad anyway. I could always play in the snow with my friends. It wouldn't be so bad. It'd be a fun story too. I was sure I could have some fun before I slept. But I'm focused on getting home now. Onto my journey, if I could call it a journey. I'd just see how well the way back went. It couldn't be that bad. Winter's fun if I enjoy it to a certain degree.
I'm
should be strong. A man should be true. A man can be handsome, but he's gotta come through. He's gotta have manners, but not too polite. There's nothing more boring than someone too tight. He's got everything I'm looking for. He's got something different. He's got more of that extra special la-di-da. What the French call je ne sais quoi. There's something about that boy. There's something about that boy. He's bringing me so much joy. I don't know what it is, but those eyes of his look through me. He's got everything that a girl can be. He's not like the others. He's so sweet, and he's almost nothing I wouldn't do to make sure that his dreams come true. There's something about that boy, or just maybe.
Snow melts on the field, and the snowman begins to droop. All traces of the night vanished.
This morning,
a blast of icy air blows through the frost-touched branch of the trees, swirling into the open air, longing to be up high. Dashing through clouds like a playful early morning breeze, soaring over the tops of trees like a bird who's just learned how to fly. It brushes against the tip of a frozen icicle, which hangs onto a branch dusted in a fine layer of snow. It drips into a stream where the water flows in a slow trickle, and the bright morning sunlight shines on the water, making it glow. The waking world comes to life as the sun rises in the sky, as the icy world of night turns to the warm land of day, where birds dance in the snow, their songs becoming less shy, and the sun smiles down on this winter world where wind and birds play.
I padded through the forest, the snow crunching beneath my paws. Snow tipped my fire-coloured bushy tail. My nose twitched as I smelled the air for anything familiar, though only the reek of rotten, dead animals and pine needles came through to me. I must find my den, I thought anxiously. The sky is already growing dark. Swishing my tail, I trotted along at a slightly faster pace, my eyes darting around me for any signs of my lost home. But as the stars glittered in the ink-black sky, I began to believe I'd never find my way back. Suddenly, something rustled in a small, dark head behind me. I turned around, ready to fight if I needed to. As I scanned it over, another fox, and a huge one at that, very similar to me, stepped out and tilted its head, as if to ask, "Why are you out here so late?" It had huge, gleaming amber eyes, which held an aura of peace and relaxation in them. Its massive paws seemed to shake the ground when it walked towards me, and I shrank back from it, spitting in a pathetic attempt to seem intimidating. It blinked at me, confused, and then began to amble on. I followed it, desperately hoping that it was going towards my den. I could barely see my own paws in front of me, it was so dark. I could scent the other fox still in front of me, but by now I doubted it actually knew where it was going. I was never going to find my den, it was over. I slumped onto the floor and whisked my tail over my eyes, whimpering. I'm not sure how much later it was, but it was bright when I was woken by the other fox pressing his face against my nose to get my attention. The once seemingly dark and gloomy forest was now full of colour and twittering birds. I staggered up, my legs shivering from the cold. Narrowing my eyes, I stared at the other fox, silently asking for answers behind being woken up. Its face was so bright and energetic, it almost felt as if it was grinning with pure joy. My gaze flickered to what was behind it, I realised why. I rushed forward, my heart aching happily. Snow had been cleared away to reveal my den, a bit sprinkled with snow, but mostly the same as I had left it. I wonder how it knew where my den was, I wondered. But it didn't matter now. I had my den back. I spun around to thank the fox for all its kindness, but I saw no one there. Not even its paw steps were visible anymore. It had gone.
Their legs were numb. Snow had sprinkled a small forest in Scotland. Wasn't snow meant to be fun? This wasn't fun at all. Trees sped past them like they were seeing them from the windows of an express train. They felt freezing, but because of how fast they were running, they were sweating. Their transient lifestyle had started when those men started coming after them and their plans. Their girlfriends were luckily now safe in a storm shelter off the coast of Orkney. They were now in Edinburgh. Snow which had seeped into their boots was now complete melted mush, which was numbing their toes every second. They stopped by a cave and quickly grabbed some random twigs scattered around the cave, and made a fluttering but weak fire which they tried to warm up, but quickly was covered. They suddenly spun around, their black hair, dark brown fur coat and boots were scattered with blood from gunshots they had received about 4 hours ago. And snow, for obvious reasons. Someone was coming. Not just anyone, those men. They both yelled, 07, surrender, and came back, and come back with us to the foundation. 07 stood, not moving, and black tentacles moved from around their back. They stood completely still as the tentacles ripped the men apart. As blood fell around them, the tentacles moved back away slowly, still dripping. You can just call me 7. Side and began to run towards Edinburgh for safety and salvation. Maybe walk from this blizzard and numbness. The ground beneath my feet creaks and crackles as the bleached grass shatters like glass. But the sky is clear and sapphire blue, and the sun appears bold and strong. The sky is diluted by the winter's cold, an image of false hope, a reflection of our feeble will, the cold and pain to see. The glistening crystals of ice stab my fingers with cold as they drift over the coarse grey pavement.
The wind is silent this morning. No wolves are pounding at my door or whistling down at my chimney. Instead, an ominous silence is settled. A soft yet obscuring mist rides. Despair, fear and pain claw at me from the murky depths of the unknown, isolating me from my surroundings, clawing me into chaos, tugging me away from the stiff fabric of reality, tearing me down into an empty, endless void of whiteness.
This is based upon a number of reflections that I've done over what Christmases and winters have been like over the years, so hopefully you'll get something from it. Winters are a very complicated subject because they're all very different. I've known winters that were very mild, and I've known winters that were incredibly icy. I have fond memories of being in middle school in our prefabricated classrooms and being able to see my breath and sitting there shivering and hoping that the heating would suddenly kick in at some point. I also remember times in the playgrounds, which were so icy that we created really, really long skid patches and had an amazing time on the ice. I remember winters that were so snowy that we travelled into the countryside and found a horse's field that was on a hill, and they were sledging down the hill at great speed over impacted ice prior to enjoying the sensation of our sledges slowing down on the crunchy, sparkling, glittering snow under the starlight. Ideally, of course, before we reached the hedgerow. I remember winters that were so cold that icicles would come down off our drainpipe, maybe even 3 or 4 feet in length. And also winters that were so cold that we would end up with thick fronds of ice on the insides of our single glazed bedroom windows. I remember winters that were defined by the snowballs, and winters that were defined by the sledging. And I remember the milder winters that were defined much more by walking in the countryside in the crisp, cool, misty air. And one time, even seeing an ice skater on Port Meadow, seemingly in its natural environment. When I was a child, one of the things that made winter so special was the tradition they used to have between Halloween and Christmas. They would always have a 6 or 7 weeks worth of children's TV series that we would be addicted to and would be compulsory viewing. I remember The Children of the Green Know and The Box of Delights especially, as well as many others. It also seemed to be a tradition of ours to watch TV shows or these days YouTube videos about Christmases long, long ago. How they were done, how they were celebrated, and the ways in which people lived then, and how things have changed over the centuries through various different rulers, different forms of politics, and different forms of origin within humanity. There is undeniably something about the cold which brings about a primal instinct to gather together with others, to do things and say things, to raise the spirits, and to show people that you love them. But no matter what the winter was really like, the most important thing to me was the connections with family and friends that I had in those various different times, and how each winter seemed to define where I was in my life journey, my personal development. The people that I knew, the faces of those times, and also the ideas, opinions and beliefs that I had at various different stages of my existence. Try and forgive the inconveniences of the cold and the worries that we have during the winter, especially this winter. It's a winter unlike any other, in my opinion. And try and focus upon how this season is going to help you in your journey. Thank you.
Hello! I hear you're here about the murderer.
Do sit down.
Oh, do get him a cup of tea.
So, tell me more about this murder.
Well, it was my dear old papa. We found him in the garden.
Dead.
And the only clue we have is the 13 specks of mud.
13 specks of mud, you see?
On his trousers. The police think it was a natural cause, but we suspect otherwise. Papa would never have 13 specks of mud on his trousers.
Let me look around the garden. I'll inspect and I'll be back in a few seconds. Thank you. I've had a bit of a look around and I can tell you who the murderer was! It was the butler! I noticed as the butler entered the kitchen, he had specks of mud on his trousers. And how many specks of mud? 13 specks of mud! He must have used the spade. He would have gotten away with it if it weren't for his trousers.
I would have gone away with this if it weren't for you meddling chatterbox.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to imagine a pea super in London, 1895. We're in Whitechapel, East London, an evil area, dark alleys, daring do's, and it's 5 years, 1895, 5 years after the Jack the Ripper had been running amok in this area. Imagine 1895, East London, Whitechapel.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Terrifying Tours. We take you around the interesting bits of East London, Whitechapel, where certain grisly events happen. In fact, these are murders, largely of ladies of the night, allegedly, perpetrated by persons or persons unknown. Now, I know we all love a good murder. And these are really good murders, I assure you.
Some of the best ways, I'm telling you.
Usually done with a grisly, nasty, sharp instrument. And certain mutilations did occur. You won't like that, I suppose, but I rather like it. And you paid me to be a tour guide. So I'll take you around all these lovely parts and show all of the nine murders which happened in various bits of Whitechapel. And you pay for this, I'm going to give you a good time, and afterwards we'll go to a pub and have a jolly good feed.
We're here for the tour, mate.
Oh, yes. That's excellent, yes. Have you paid?
Oh, yeah, totally.
And may I acquire your name, sir?
John.
John. Yeah. It begins with a J, I believe.
Yeah.
As in, oh, well, never mind.
Yeah.
But John, J, okay, John. Yes. And you, sir?
I am Charles, Judge Charles Braithwaite.
A judge?
Certainly.
Well, I'm very honoured honoured with your presence, sir. You obviously know about the law and things to do with murders and things.
Yes. Yes.
Well, excellent. And you have some ideas about these things, do you, sir?
I believe I can shed some light on all of this.
My goodness. Well, you're very welcome. And at the course of the tour, I hope you'll enlighten us, sir.
I'd love to.
Excellent. Fine. Off we go.
May I suggest we pop to the Whitechapel Gallery?
I wouldn't recommend going there. Obviously, you're a man of the law. You wouldn't be interested in going to the Whitechapel Gallery now, would you, mate?
I beseech you. We need to go to the gallery.
Why should we go to the Whitechapel Gallery?
I don't see why we should go there at all.
No, I'm asking the judge.
Boring, really.
He wants to go to the Whitechapel Gallery.
Young man!
What?
Please be quiet.
Do tell us, sir, why do you want to go to the Whitechapel Gallery?
I believe there's evidence there that might shed light on all of this. Indeed, giveaway, there is. Jack the Ripper.
My goodness. Wow. Yes. What sort of evidence might that be, sir? Do you have any idea? Can you share it with us, sir? What are we thinking?
Well, there is a portrait.
Portrait?
And if we examine it closely, we will soon be able to tell.
Do you know which one it is, mate?
Where's the portrait, sir?
In the Whitechapel Gallery.
My
it's
goodness.
Certainly down the road.
Just close to us.
It is indeed.
Close to where the Ripper did his work.
Tell you what, I think it's a bit of a walk, a bit of a jog round the block. I'll nip down and I'll see you there shortly, shall I? Wonderful.
Joe, yes, Joe. Joe. With the Joe, please.
We should hurry up. Go and see this.
Follow this chap, his name begins with J.
Yes.
Yes, right, okay, let's do that.
His name, Jack.
Joe. He says it's Jay. Joe, where's Jay? Rather similar to Jack in a way.
Right.
Let's call yourself. Why don't we round the block twice already, mate? Come on.
Hold on a minute.
My goodness.
Ooh!
The picture frame.
It's gone.
My word, the picture's gone.
I wonder where it is.
I cry foul play.
Absolutely.
Maybe we'll never know who Jack the Ripper is.
No, probably begins with a J. Oh my goodness.
Stop that man! Stop that man!
Long time no see.
Yeah, I've been alright. We must meet up again soon. Catch up over a cup of tea. Even better, afternoon tea at the Randolph.
That might be a bit difficult, Roger, dear, given the recent circumstances. Now that I've moved on, our lives are very different.
I know. But you made an unexpected visit today. Maybe you can make another one.
You need to move on. I've moved on. Life moves on. Stop living in the past.
Truth be told, I haven't moved on.
It's hard, it's very hard, that I'm no longer here with you, but you seem to be doing all right. You seem happy, comfortable, relaxed. You've got everything. You've got the whole world in your hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
That was great. Reminds me
of
a good
old time. I do sometimes wish I was still here to experience the good times with you. But hey ho, life moves on.
Why are you so optimistic all the time? Doesn't what's happened ever affect you?
No, not really. I just try and think about different things to take my mind off things, like where I am now.
To be honest, it's the memories that keep me going. It's amazing, isn't it, how memories can stick with you forever. It feels like you're reliving.
It can only get better for you, my friend. Anyway, I must shoot off now.
Goodbye, my darling.
It was. Anyway, lots of love. Bye.
Goodbye, my angel.
Goodbye.
Sit back and relax and forget about it.
Good idea.
I have something to ask you.
Go on. Wait, if it's another one of your rants, I'm going to zone out.
Nothing new there.
If it's about not how to become so emotionally attached to your family, then I told you before, this is a hard job that requires our full attention.
Tell me about it. But no, it's not that. You're constantly reminding me. It's about that bloke in the park.
Roger?
Yeah, him.
What is it about him? He seems sweet, has a memorable face.
Well, I noticed some things that seem a bit peculiar, to say the least.
Want to vent to me? What things have you noticed?
Well, he seems a bit lonely. He's always on his own on that same park bench. Has this thing happened to him? Like his inner thoughts have taken over?
I haven't really noticed that. He always seems to be enjoying himself. Without humming, singing and dancing.
But what if he's hiding something? What if deep down he's struggling? He might be traumatised by something. He's an old man. 40% of men don't talk up and hide their depression.
Why are you having such a cancer approach to this? He's a regular person like us, not patient.
But remember, it's our job!
But as I said, the weekends are a time to forget about our worries. Last thing I need is a new case on my head.
I just can't help thinking that if we don't help him, he'll be that one person in that one scenario who dies, and we regret it, and I can't live with that shame!
I know the feeling. It's hard enough not to feel so emotionally attaching, but he's not our responsibility.
Why do I always get so committed to the random things?
The normal feeling of a job like this, don't be ashamed.
So, can we just have one visit to him just to try and talk and to find out some more?
Really?
Pretty please?
Fine, just because it's you.
Thanks.
You and me around in the pub though.
Gotcha.
Well, Beth, it's been lovely seeing you again. But why are you back so soon?
Excuse me, mate. Are you alright? Who are you talking to?
Yeah, surprise me too. But if you can, do come again.
What surprised you? Who should come and visit again? What are you on about?
Maybe just give him a break. Turn it down a bit. We don't know enough about him.
1997 was when you left.
Who left? Did you go for a breakup?
That might be a bit personal.
No, not everyone does understand.
Roger, who are you talking to? What don't people understand?
Hi Roger, my name's Jamie and this is Blake. We're here to help. Talk to us if you need.
How long have you been struggling for? Is it a long term or a short term illness?
If you have anything to say, it's a safe place.
Do you have a home? Who do you talk to?
We're going to leave you be now, Roger. But if you need us, call us.
Why are you so desperate to leave? This guy obviously needs our help.
Yeah, well, you're interrogating him. The city's on news site isn't going to help his mental state.
And I get that, which is why I'm trying to find out more. But your lackluster approach, who are you going to call? Mental breakdown savers? Isn't going to work.
Yeah, well, you're interrogating him as if he's on news site isn't going to help his mental state if he's bad already.
How else am I going to find out what's going on? Give me a DNA test and track his history.
Well, being all aggressive isn't going to help.
Well, your gentle approach isn't getting us anywhere.
Okay, let's just leave him. He doesn't need our help.
And I thought you and Mr. Let's Not Jump to a Conclusion.
Well, that's a better conclusion than harassing him until he tells us his life story.
Roger! Tell me what's going on! What's happened in your life? Who are you talking to? Why do you always sit at this same park bench?
Can we go now? I'm getting cold.
We will be back, Roger!
Alright, wait. that you handled that brilliantly.
As if you handled it any better.
Well, at least I didn't make him feel uncomfortable. You know, no wonder he didn't respond to me. What if that guy had dementia? He might confuse the living daylights out of him.
You know, this really reminds me of the situation with Rodney.
Yes, I remember him, but where's his rebellion from this situation?
Well, you did this exact thing.
What thing?
Acting as if we shouldn't get involved and it's not our business. And where did that lead Rodney, huh? Did.
Well, it's true, it's not a problem to get involved in.
But don't you get it? It's our job. We always see those adverts on TV for a Britain Gate talking. There's no harm in trying to see if Roger wanted to talk.
But what if that guy was already getting help? What if he was perfectly normal place and you just triggered him to get worse? How would you feel then?
No. Why are you blaming this all on me? It wasn't just me. You kept interrogating him as well, didn't you?
But at least I had boundaries and you didn't.
Mr. Hypocrite.
What do you mean, hypocrite?
Well, you go on about it if you already had someone to help. But you're the one who said, we're here and we need to talk. Oh, and saying he might have dementia.
And that's better than saying, has someone just died? Who was the one who stood up to talk things through? Me. And who was the one who got us to leave? Oh, there's a surprise to me.
I've been loving your regular visits, Bethany.
When did Bethany die?
How old are you, Bethany? My brain, it gets forgetful, to say the least. You were 65 when you died, and now you're 71.
So she died in 2016.
Why do you keep visiting me? You always say you'll never come back, yet you do.
Do you miss Bethany, then?
That explains why you always see her.
Oh, Bethany, my life's been the same old, same old. Still rotting you on this park bench. Nobody notices me. It's not fair.
We're here, right next to you, Roger.
Roger, it's us. We're talking to you, remember?
Bethany, I miss Roger, you more than ever.
You need to look around. You're not alone. You have support. You can't rely on me anymore.
It's okay to miss her, but there are people around you.
I wish you were still here, then we could have all the fun like we used to.
What did you guys used to get up to?
Remember, we used to have fires, play games together, play Scrabble, play Conkers, and we used to dance and sing songs.
Sounds like you two enjoy each other's company.
You can still have fun without Bethany. Let the memories live on. You can create new memories to cherish for the rest of your lives, like the one made with Bethany.
I understand now, Bethany. Really, I do. I've got to move on. Stop living in the past. Your visits have been a regular good tonic, but now I've got to move on.
Is she leaving now?
Goodbye, Bethany. Until we meet again.
Hi, Roger. My name's Jamie, and this is Blake.
What lovely names. Have we met before?
Not in the past, but recently we've come up to you.
So what's life like for you then, Roger?
Well, I live here, on this bench.
Why is that?
Ain't it bleeding obvious, got nowhere else to live.
And what do you get up to?
Well, not much. Just sit here contemplating my life as many different ways as I can. Life's been different since Bethany passed.
6 years ago, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's right. But the past four have been very different, very difficult.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Is there any particular reason why?
Well, it's Bethany, see? She's been coming back to me. We have a visit, we have a catch-up like the good old times and sing song, and then she leaves. She's right in front of me. And then she's gone.
Do you think that you're having flashbacks, or is it just memories?
No. I hold her hand, and I hear her voice, and I know that's not memories.
Oh, that is strange. Well, I'm sure you must miss her very much.
You know, Roger, you remind me of this guy I used to work with. Roger was his name. Always had a smile on his face, always had a story to tell, and always had a jolly old time.
Oh, I remember him.
course, his wife as well, didn't he?
Yes, so what do you imagine the future to be like? Get a house, move to a hostel?
I don't know where I want my life to go, to be honest. Truth be told, I've moved on from previous events.
That's all right, Roger. Grief takes its time and is different for everyone. You've obviously been through a lot over the past few years and you're still recovering.
But will I ever get over this? Will I ever have a home to live in? Will my life improve?
Well, I'm not a fortune teller, but if you get the correct help, then maybe.
And we're here to help what you need and want.
Yeah, it's my job to help people like you. And trust me, there are a few of them in similar situations.
Well, maybe I could use some help. But what could you two do for someone like me?
Well, we can find a hostel for you. There are places where people who are struggling, they can stay warm and have food and a place to live and sleep.
That would be lovely.
Well, obviously it does take time to get to these places, but you can move in with us for a time being.
I think I'd like to stay here for just one more night. Just to say goodbye and all that sort of sentimental stuff.
Sure, that's fine, Roger. We'll come back tomorrow and check in on you.
Bye, Roger.
Bye, we'll be back to check in tomorrow morning.
Thank you very much.
Hi Roger, we've come to check in on you. Are you going to take a power offer?
Where's Roger?
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 Where's Roger?
He's at 5-9.
No need for the attitude.
I knew this is a bad idea.
Oh, don't start that!
I mean, what a predicament. Just as we get him the help, his needs, everything goes all wrong.
Listen, I'm sure everything will be okay. I know you weren't keen on this situation, and this probably won't help change your mind.
Touché, you can say that again.
What's this?
In love and memory of Roger Harold Moore, 1922-2018.
This can't be!
But we were talking to him yesterday, weren't we?
Excuse me! Is Roger Harold Moore still in this area?
No, he died 4 years ago.
Okay, thank you. I just don't get it. How is this possible? We are talking to him, interacting with him, watching him hallucinate.
Hallucinations, that's it.
What do you mean?
Well, all this time we've been saying Roger reminds us someone and other situations. However, Roger keeps on going about staying in memories. I'm sure we worked with Roger on several occasions after his wife died 6 years ago.
Oh, what? So you're suggesting we're remembering Roger in our heads?
Precisely. In a job like ours, it's an internally plausible option as we constantly deal with clients who unfortunately pass away.
I do remember how he was always up for a laugh and told several stories to us, and he'd be up for playing games no matter what the situation or his age.
I know, and this is exactly what we've been reliving.
Oh, I'm so sorry I dragged you into this in the first place.
I'm really sorry I kept doubting you.
Thank you.